On behalf of my college, Hiralal Mazumdar Memorial College for Women, I'd like to welcome Dr. Jain, Dr. Mukherjee, and Dr. Abul Kalam for their gracious presence in this webinar. Hope that their deliberation will definitely enlighten us and we will start thinking about some mechanisms regarding effective scientific and technological approach in combating COVID-19 across the world. This COVID-19 has shaken our thoughts. So we are waiting eagerly for thought-provoking lectures from our esteemed resource persons. Without wasting much time, I'd like to hand it over to Pradipto for continuing the session. Thank you, Dr. Jain, Dr. Mukherjee, and Dr. Abul Kalam. And of course, my gratitude goes to my senior colleagues, right from Professor Dibakant Jha, Sonali Mukherjee, Lipika Mallick, Rupa Sen, and of course, my junior colleagues, each and everyone who have always made me feel proud for being their colleague. Thank you. Pradipto, continue, please.
Sure, madam. It is always a pleasure to have our principal with us because she is in a dynamic mood. Whenever we ask for anything, that madam, we are going to organize such seminar or webinar, she is there to help us at any moment. So with this, I would like to call our moderator, Dr. Sonali Mukherjee, to give our deliberation. Dr. Sonali Mukherjee. She will be the moderator for today's webinar.
Thank you, Pradipto. Once again, I want to tell you all the participants, I request all participants to mute their audio and off their video throughout the session. Use only the chat box only for query during the webinar. After the lecture, if we have enough time, then resource persons will give you the answers or it may be delivered in the chat box as it will be convenient at that time. Thank you and nothing more. Please, Dr. Rehan. Dr. Rehan, are you here?
Yes, I am.
Please introduce our first speaker.
Well, good morning, everyone who all present here. So let's start the program. Very first of all, I thanks to respected principal ma'am for giving me this opportunity to introduce the speakers. Well, for today's speakers, we have Dr. Vaibhav Jain, who will deliver his lecture very first of all. Second speaker is Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee. And third and last speaker is Dr. Abul Kalam. So let's start with the session with Dr. Vaibhav Jain. Well, about the Vaibhav Jain, I don't think so there is any particular vocabulary is need to express about him. Well, he is an individual with terrific medical temperament. As far as his educational qualification is concerned, Dr. Vaibhav Jain has completed his MBBS degree from Muzaffarnagar Medical College. And he did his post-graduation in cardiology from Yashoda Hospital, Hyderabad. After completion of his post-graduation in cardiology, he took an admission in the MBA with a specialization in hospital management. And he completed same from ICFA University, Hyderabad. Now the best part of his career, he is pursuing as research fellow at Mayo Clinic, Rochester, United States of America. This Mayo Clinic Rochester is itself as a big brand in the field of cardiology. So we can understand the thinking level and the other part of Mr. Meral Jain. So I would like to request Mr. Dr. Meral Jain to start the session.
Thank you, Rehan, for your kind words. A very good morning to everyone. Let me just share my presentation. Give me 1 second. Can everyone see my screen?
No, sir. We are unable to see your screen. Yeah. Thank you. Now we can see, sir.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much, Rehan, for your kind words. A very good morning and everyone. Let's discuss about COVID-19 complications. What will be the learning objective for today? Am I visible now?
Yeah, sir. Please carry on.
So what will be your learning objective for today? We'll be discussing about the brief outline of COVID-19. Just give me 1 second, it's getting some error. Okay. And the risk factors as well as the complications. So, but before we jump to actually the complications, let's discuss what is COVID-19. Coronavirus disease is caused by the SARS coronavirus 2, which is a RNA beta coronavirus. Coronaviruses being a large family of viruses infect both animals and humans, or sometimes they spread to humans through animals as intermediate hosts, like Middle East respiratory syndrome, which happened in 2003, then severe acute respiratory syndrome, and now the coronavirus disease 19. Coronavirus disease 19 is first identified in Wuhan, China in December 19. Initially, the case was linked to seafood and live animal market in Wuhan, though it spreads person to person through respiratory droplets. Why is everyone talking about COVID? Do we really need to worry about it? Well, WHO had declared the coronavirus as pandemic earlier this year in February 2020. Globally, more than 180 countries have been affected by the impact of coronavirus. Till now, there is no specific treatment, and the current guidelines include only supportive treatment and some of the off-label use of the medicines. There are some clinical trials about the medicines and vaccines which are showing some hope, though still in clinical trials. R0, which is a measure to see the infectivity of the disease, is quite high, roughly 2.2 to 3. The government and healthcare agencies are thus emphasizing to control the spread by means of face mask, social distancing, and other measures like quarantine. As we speak, we have more than 9 million confirmed cases of coronavirus throughout the globe, and almost 500,000 deaths have been recorded. Let's discuss about the clinical symptoms what coronavirus disease can cause. People with coronavirus disease can have wide range of symptoms, ranging from mild symptoms to severe illness, which usually appears 2 to 14 days after exposure. It is usually fever more than 100.5 degrees centigrade, chills, cough, shortness of breath, fatigue, muscle or body ache, headache, new loss of taste or smell, sore throat, congestion or runny nose, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. But the good point is most people recover after general flu-like symptoms. Who are at risk? Are elders? It is generally seen that as the age advances, some of the systemic diseases like diabetes, hypertension, and other comorbidities are more prone in this population group. So they are higher prevalence of contracting any disease. People living in nursing home, old age home, or long-term care facility are more prone. healthcare workers or those who are in close contact with these patients. There are some medical conditions which puts you under risk. All those conditions which decrease the immune system of a person or those which affect the respiratory or cardiovascular symptoms of the body are more prone to develop these diseases. Diseases such as chronic lung disease like asthma, COPD, serious heart conditions, immunocompromised state, and then severe obesity, usually BMI of more than 40 or higher, diabetes, hypertension, chronic kidney disease, undergoing dialysis, liver disease. It is a well-known fact that complications do happen. And as Dr. Gavinde quoted, 97% of the time, if you come to the hospital, everything goes well. But 3% of the time, we have major complications. And these complications can vary from individual to individual. Let's discuss about the complications of coronavirus. Initially, SARS coronavirus enter the body as an airborne infection through nose or mouth and reaching up to the lungs. The virus rapidly grows and multiplies, causing the inflammation of the cells of the respiratory system and leading to cell death. Subsequently, the virus spreads out and damages other vital organs and tissues, triggering a complicated spectrum of pathophysiological changes and symptoms, including cardiovascular complications. Let us look at the mechanism of coronavirus, how it enters the body and then multiplies. After entering the host body, the S-glycoprotein. Can you see my mouse here? So S-glycoprotein, this is S-glycoprotein, which attaches itself to the epithelial cell with the help of angiotensin converting enzyme, which is highly expressed in lungs and heart. This damages the epithelium and activates immune cells. Here you go, these destroying the epithelium and destroys immune cells, further leading to replication and release of the virus genome. The acute inflammatory response leads to release of cytokine, which is a marker of inflammation, which causes symptoms like fever, respiratory symptoms, and hypoxia. Now, from this injury and virus response, it further spreads to other vital organs, leading to multi-organ failure. Let's look at the cardiovascular complications, what it can cause. Usually, it causes acute cardiac injury, seen in almost 8 to 12% of patients. Then heart failure. One study has recorded up to 52% of those patients who died had heart failure and the arrhythmias. This can be acute cardiac injury, which further leads to heart failure or complicated arrhythmias. As we have already discussed about the entry of virus into the cell, let's see how it affects the cardiac cells. It can happen by direct myocardial injury by binding to angiotensin converters enzyme. This binding of enzyme to SARS virus can result in alteration of ACE2 signaling pathways, leading to acute myocardial and lung injury. Then systemic inflammation form of COVID, which are more serious and characterized by acute systemic inflammatory response and cytokine storm, which can result in injury to multiple organs, leading to multi-organ failure. Some studies have shown that high circulatory levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines in patients with severe and critical COVID-19. Also, the increased cardiometabolic demand associated with systemic inflammation along with hypoxia can impair myocardial oxygen demand supply relationship and lead to acute myocardial injury, leading to symptoms like of STEMI, heart attack. And then this systemic inflammation as well as increased shear stress due to increased coronary blood flow. Here you can see plaque rupturing. Can cause plaque rupture resulting in acute myocardial infarction. And then the adverse effect of some of the various therapies which are used in COVID-19, like antiviral drugs, corticosteroids, and other therapies aimed at treating coronavirus can also have deleterious effect on the cardiovascular symptom. There are some major signs and biomarkers which are seen in the patients with respiratory and cardiovascular diseases. One of the major is lactate dehydrogenase, which usually is seen more than 245 units per liter. And then the main marker is high sensitive cardiac troponin, which is usually seen in patients with myocarditis or heart failure or STEMI. And then in respiratory symptoms, patient have usually a heart rate of, respiratory rate of more than 24 beats per minute, or they can have hypoxia, hypercapnia. Let's discuss let us divide the coronavirus patients, cardiac patients, in three groups. Those who have previous established cardiovascular diseases, or those who have risk factors, and the third one, de novo, those who don't have any disease previously and they are developing a fresh disease. So in pre-established disease, it can have prior myocardial infarction or rheumatic heart disease, which is quite common in countries like India, and then the heart failure, arrhythmia, or the cardiomyopathies. Risk factors like diabetes, hypertension, or reduced heart function due to prior myocardial infarction, or de novo disease, those who are new diseases like myocarditis, cardiomyopathy, or acute heart attack, treatment of COVID, shock, or the cardiac arrest. Some studies have been done in several countries, and one study which has been done in many countries, including Italy, Spain, Korea, Iran, have highlighted the impact of cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, and hypertension in patients with coronavirus. A group from China have found the prevalence of hypertension up to 35% in patients with coronavirus. The overall case fatality rate has been found to be around 2.3%, while reaching up to 10.5% in patients with cardiovascular diseases, which is quite high. It's not just about the prevalence of the infection more in patients with risk factors. It is also seen that these cohort have severe impact of the disease. One study has found that those patients who had hypertension were getting more admission in ICU than without hypertension. Similarly, those patients with risk factor were more prone to risk of death than without risk factors. Another group of patients who have complications are due to the treatment of coronavirus disease. Sometime back, there was a big hype about the hydroxychloroquine, which is itself causes some cardiac complications like the prolongation of QTC, leading to arrhythmia and heart blocks. Then a recent medicine which has been launched in the market is Fenfluramine, which interacts with anticoagulants, leading to anemia. Let's see what are the drugs which cause interaction and causes complications in cardiac patients. HCQ, which interacts with beta blockers and causes QT prolongation, or some QT prolonging drugs like azithromycin, or steroids, which Oxford has recently published a trial in serious complicated patients. It interferes with warfarin, so you need to monitor INR based on the patients who are already taking warfarin. Coronavirus can also cause severe arrhythmias, like abnormality of the heart rhythm, which can be in the form of atrioventricular block, atrial fibrillation, polymorphic VT, that is a fast heart rate, or pulseless electrical activity. Let's see some of the ECG and X-rays which have been taken from the coronavirus patients. Like in this X-ray, you can see multifocal pneumonia here and the cardiomegaly, which is the increased size of the heart. And the ECG is showing high-grade heart block with unstable junctional rhythm, which is quite common in these patients. Another X-ray is showing bilateral lower lobe opacities here, and then ECG showing AF with fast ventricular rate. One of the another patient here, you can see bilateral patchy opacities, all these areas, and then ECG showing polymorphic VT, and then torsade, which is quite common in patients who are taking these medicines. And then the last, this ECG, here you can see T inversions and QT prolongation, more in patients with hydroxychloroquine. And then again in this X-ray, you can see patchy bilateral opacities all throughout the lungs, and then LBB with heart block. So what we can guess, say from these all studies, that those patients who have prior cardiovascular disease and now getting coronavirus positive have to have more conscious about their disease. So they need to be taken more care because they have more complications and have sequelae. Let's discuss about the respiratory complications. We've already discussed about the mechanism of entry into the host cell. And after getting entry into the lungs, it acts through renin-angiotensin system inhibition and then leading to inflammation of the lung injury. This was a study which was done in multicentric in 24 countries and 235 hospitals from January to March 2020. And in this study, they have observed around 51% of patients had pulmonary complications. This study included 128 patients, surgical patients, out of which 825 had emergency surgery and 280 had elective surgery. Most of them with complications were elderly, above 70, and had diabetes and hypertension. In this study, each participating hospital had all those patients who had undergone surgery were tested for COVID before 7 days or after 30 days of the surgery. Blood vessels in the lungs, eventually a patient starts getting shortness of breath and can lead to acute respiratory distress syndrome, a form of lung failure, which later leads to sepsis and superinfection. Some of the data has shown that people with history of smoking are more prone to disease with increased severity. In fact, in smokers, the risk of severe symptoms is 1.4 times higher than non-smokers, and risk of admission to ICUs and requirement of mechanical ventilation is up to, or even death, is up to 2.4 times higher. We can measure the severity of a disease, mild, moderate, just on the basis of clinical symptoms like breathing difficulty or fever, and can be done by chest X-ray or CT scan, and obviously confirmation by the lab tests. But this can be clinically managed at home as well. But more serious patients, like those who require ventilation or the ECMO group, have some major complications. Like they require high PaO2, FiO2, and with a peak on ventilator as well. Actually, this is an interesting X-ray. The first X-ray was taken at the time of the admission when the patient got admitted, and it was almost normal. But the second X-ray, you can see just after 2 days, it shows a lot of opacities here. And this patient need to be intubated on the second day itself, so you can see how the disease progresses too soon. Similarly, this image of the CT scan shows here fibrosis and ground glass opacities, which is the main feature of COVID-19, the ground glass opacities. In fact, one of the studies which found out that ground glass opacities was found in even 88% of the patients, like initially it was 44%, which gradually increased to 88% of the patients who had COVID-19 and ground glass opacities and consolidation. Let's discuss about the management. The gold standard test is RT-PCR, which is polymerase chain reaction, but due to its limitation of not availability of everyone, every place, and long duration of the result, so some of the newer tests like antibody and antigen-based immunoassay have been developed, though still they are in trial phases, and sometimes they are, at some places they have been tested as well, and obviously the clinical test like clinical features and then CT and the X-ray. Management, usually the mild symptoms can be treated at home and they don't require hospitalization. Isolation is necessary to contain the transmission so that it doesn't spread to other persons. And then symptomatic treatments like antipyretic for fever, hydration, and general measures. So more complicated patients or the critically ill patients require hospitalization. They require oxygen support as the requirement. And then if required, they may require ventilation or the ECMO, which is high end for the ventilation, or the prone positioning, which is quite helpful these days. Drugs, though all are in clinical trial phase, nothing has been approved as of now, these drugs. So HCQ, glucocorticoids recently been given by the Oxford University. So this is only been proven in the high patients, critically ill patients, not for the general population for the prevention. And similarly with other medicines like remdesivir, lopinavir, and even the antihelminthic medicines like ivermectin. So they have been still in the clinical trial phase. I think this is just the basic idea of how the mechanism of drug development, which is like, we have to stop the viral entry into the blood, into the body. This can be done by hydroxychloroquine. It's still in the trial phase. And other medicines like other blocker, RDBDP, is being used by fipivapine. Asthma is really helpful in these patients. What actually it is, all those patients who have been recovered from coronavirus disease, or all those who have mild disease, so they have been screened in the general population, and from those populations, the blood is taken out, and then it is centrifuged, divided, which is plasma and RBC. This RBC is again given to the donor, so only the plasma is taken, and this plasma contains virus neutralizing antibody, And then this is given to the patients or to the exposure who, for prevention. So most of the study has been done on the COVID-19 patients. Very few are done on the COVID-19 exposure. So this is quite helpful these days. There have been several vaccines which are under still trial phase. Important is by the Moderna, which is still in trial two, phase two of the trial. Prevention, so main aim to spread the infection is the prevention. Reduce your hand hygiene and social surveys. Finally, to sum up, initially in the early phase, it's the viral response which takes care. And then as the disease progresses, it's the host inflammatory response phase. So initially at the time of early infection, a patient may have mild constitutional symptoms like fever or dry cough. And later as the disease progresses, it's more of a breathing difficulty, shortness of breath, which is usually seen by the chest imaging. And then at the end stage like ARDS or circulatory cardiac failure. Still, no drug is approved. They are all in the clinical trial phase. That's it. Thank you so much. I'm happy to take any questions.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, Kariban, please carry on.
Thank you, sir. There is no question in the chat box, but your lecture was so much attractive and informative. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Rehan?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, yes.
Please for the next. Please for the next.
Yeah.
And Dr. Rehan?
Yes.
Will you please request again? We are sending the good mornings and the email, etc. in chat box. The chat box is becoming so jammed. Please ask them not to send anything else but queries.
Okay. Dear participants, good morning, Manu, all present here. I request you, please don't wish good morning or whatever. You just use the chat box for any important query. Okay, please maintain the decorum of the webinar. And thank you very much, Vaibhav sir, seriously, for a wonderful presentation. The way you have explained, the way you really pass the information by, you know, with the help of a beautiful slide, I'm mesmerized. And really, thanks a lot for this, you know, this presentation.
Dr. Rehan? Just now here is a question.
Yes. Please, ma'am, carry on.
If you can shortly explain the plasma treatment.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Let me just quickly pull up the slide as well, which will be easy for you. Give me 1 second. It's my slide. Is it over there?
No, sir. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it is.
Okay. So.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. What is plasma treatment actually? All those patients who develop COVID-19, they have antibody in their bodies due to the disease. So, since they have recovered, we take the advantage of these antibodies. We take their whole blood from the blood, they donate their blood, and then that blood is passed through a machine called a centrifuge machine, which takes the plasma out and RBC separately. So this RBC, we don't need this RBC. This is again transferred to the patient, the donor who has given his blood, and only the plasma is taken. This plasma, this contains the antibody of the disease. So when we are transferring this plasma to the patient, so this already has, this is like vaccine, working as a normal vaccine. So this patient is getting advantage of this plasma. Am I clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, there is another question. Who are recovered can again catch the virus?
There have been several studies, but it's like 0.1%. Only a few studies have reported from China, those who have disease and then later getting the infection. But it's not necessary that you will get the infection. Only a few patients, not everyone.
Okay, thank you, sir. Dr. Dehan, please proceed.
Vaibhav sir, really we will be grateful to you if you provide the slide to our college mail so that we can use the whole slide in for future for the knowledge.
Sure.
So yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And really, okay, so let's start our next session with Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee, ma'am. Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee, ma'am, did graduate and postgraduate in zoology, and after the completion of the graduation in zoology, she completed her doctoral degree from Bengal Engineering and Science University. If I'm not wrong, this institute upgraded into Indian Institute of Engineering Science and Technology, Shibpur, Howrah. Her doctoral work was on waste water management of Kolkata city. In context of research work, we can conclude that her research interest is in environmental toxicology and bioremediation. She done extensive work on the effect of ecological factors on sewage feed fisheries of East Kolkata wetland. She has worked on soil arsenic remediation in Atghara area of West Bengal, also on bioacclimation and biomagnification of different heavy metals. Well, in context of her current position, we can say she is serving as a professor and head of department at the Department of Biotechnology, University of Engineering and Management, Kolkata. Well, in context of her publication, we can conclude she has authored many journal and conference papers. She has edited many books. She published many, publications in many national and international journals of repute. She wrote many books, but among them, the best two are, which is a prominent throughout the country, throughout the nation, throughout the world, which are, one is Environmental Biotechnology for Soil and Wastewater Implication on Ecosystem by, and this book is published by publisher Springer in the year 2019. Apart from this book, she also wrote another very important book which got very fame. The name of that book is Biotechnology and Biological Sciences. And this book was published by Taylor and Francis Publication in the year 2019. The two books which I have mentioned is very a renowned book of, or you can say the very prominent work of Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee, ma'am. She has a tremendous research, work. She has really, she is editor of many other journals, including American Journals for Applied Biotechnology Research. Her research work can be recognized by many things, but the two things you can say she has applied for the two patent. So as a student of a science or the teacher of science, we can say if someone applied for two patents means must have done something extra, must have invented or must have discovered something so that she applied for the patent. I request to Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee, ma'am, please start your session.
Thank you, Dr. Rehan. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Thank you so much. Thank you for this introduction. I am not that good, actually. Thank you to the organizers for organizing such a wonderful, you know, webinar on such a contemporary topic. It is a very deserved and required one. And thank you, Dr. Rehan, again for inviting me to speak in such a among such an august gathering. So, I'm sure all the participants, you are listening on different aspects of COVID. Yesterday there was a discussion, and this morning also there was a wonderful session by Dr. Vaibhav Jain, and you are enriched. So my discussion will be focusing on the vaccine development. So I will just discuss, I will not enter into very detail of the vaccine, but I will discuss on the importance and different aspects, certain concern area regarding the functionality or regarding the efficiency of the vaccines we are expecting. So let me share my slide.
It's okay, ma'am.
Just a minute, huh?
Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
No, it's visible.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, it's visible.
Almost every day, I work with Google this meet, but now it has created certain problem. It's very strange.
Thank you anyway, very much. Please carry on.
Thank you. So SARS-CoV-2, severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS, and it's a COVID virus. So there was earlier to this SARS-CoV-2, there were a lot of viral infections. I mean, in the near past, we can mention there was Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, there was H1N1 Middle East Respiratory Syndrome in 2012, there was H1N1 flu virus 2019, there was SARS-CoV 2002-2003. So there were a lot of other, I mean many more, virus outbreaks. And there are others, coronavirus, human coronaviruses are also there. But this SARS-CoV-2 has created so much panic across the globe, so that the WHO has declared a public health emergency situation. So we can understand the importance of discussion on this virus. One major reason is this virus is highly contagious. Human to human infection is spreading very fast. It started in China. And in December 2019, we came across the news of the virus. We are not that much serious at that point of time. It was in China. And within a span of few months, only in June, we see it has, you know, spread throughout the globe. And in India, it is now increasing rapidly. So definitely, all of us are looking for some hope. The only hope is probably vaccine. Because as doctor said earlier, that a lot of work is also going on drug development, but nothing has actually come up, starting from hydroxychloroquine to now some Ayurvedic drugs are also, people are saying, all of you know, I think it's coming regularly in media, but nothing is actually tested to be, you know, very good or tested to be very positive. So people are scared because there is fatality and mortality involved in it. People are scared and everybody is looking for vaccine. So I will focus on the my discussion on this vaccine definitely. Little bit of research work I will touch upon. I have not done. I will share some others' research. I will touch upon on the vaccine development. What is the vaccine target for this particular virus? And also there are certain concern area which I want to raise in this scientific forum. So if I go to the next slide, is it visible? Is it visible?
Yes, madam, totally visible.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, please carry on.
Thank you. So this COVID-19 virus, you see its spherical look and it's having spikes. Many spikes are there, right? These spikes are, you can say, it's giving this virus adaptive feature. With the help of these are glycoproteins, basically, the spikes. With the help of these spikes, this virus can sit on the host, whichever, maybe if the human cell, and it fuses with the plasma membrane and inserts the nucleic acid, thus then the replication, then the protein synthesis, and thus the spread of the virus. So the spike proteins, you can understand the spike proteins are very important target, right? Because this is giving the virus the opportunity to fix and the transfer of the nucleic acid. It is a positive strand RNA virus plus sense. The virus genomic sequence has been, virus genome has been sequenced, and it is, the genome sequence was actually, I got the information, the earlier one, the Chinese one, the sample collected from China, that was sequenced, and it is around 29,000 to 30,000 BP stretch of this genome. And its genome virus, COVID-19 or COV2 viral genome has got sequence similarity with COV1, you can say, the 2002-2003 COV. Also, it has got sequence similarity with MERS-CoV and also bat coronavirus. So it is a zoonotic pathogen, and people are saying that the bat is probably the reservoir host of COV-19. So going to straight on vaccine development, I think all of us know that vaccine development means is basically you are inserting some part of the pathogen inside the host body so that the host is not getting ill, not developing much symptom, but at the same time host is developing antibody so that it can fight against further infection. So that is the basic thing. So you are acquiring immunity through vaccination process. So in the vaccine development process, one thing is very important, that is you have to identify the specific target for vaccine, which portion of the virus, because it is specific to pathogen. For that, you need to understand the pathogen well. You need to understand, of course, you need to understand its gene sequence, its total sequence. You need to observe the pathogen. You need to grow the pathogen to understand which part will be the best vaccine target. Sorry, anything? Sorry, is there any problem? Sorry, is there any problem?
No, madam. There is no problem, madam. Please carry on.
So for vaccine development, one important aspect is to identify the vaccine target, which will give the maximum immune response to the host. This is number one. And there are techniques. Number two is the technique we will apply, which technique we will apply. There are different techniques, because when we are inserting the pathogen in the host, we have to remember that the person is not, should not be ill. So it has to be either live attenuated, like we have vaccines are there, which are live attenuated by vaccine, or maybe treated like heat killed or chemically treated, or maybe the total nucleic acid is used as vaccine component, or maybe the recombinant protein is used. So you have to define the technique. There are different techniques, but you have to define which technique we'll be using for vaccine development. That is again very important one. And already I will share one research work here. Just a minute, a work published in June by the researchers at Cancer Genomic and Biocomputing and Complex Diseases Lab, Berlin University, Israel. They have identified 15 potential immunodominant region and 25 immunodominant epitopes of SARS-CoV-2 proteins. Now you have to identify the specific epitope or the specific sequence. But at the same time, you need to test that which actually they have done in terms of the expression of MHC molecules. So the interaction of major histocompatibility complex, which is the immune response of the host, part of immune response of the host, major histocompatibility complex molecule, it's a protein, and its interaction with the antigen or the viral protein epitope. So that needs to be tested, and that they have done the testing, and they interestingly they have identified finally 7 epitopes were found to have they have identified 7 such epitopes in 87% of worldwide infected COVID infected patients. They have also done a bioinformatics study on the protein protein interaction, how this protein protein interaction between the epitope and the histocompatibility complex protein. So this is one important work, and there is another work published in Nature Review in Immunology, June 2020, by Texas Children's Center for Vaccine Development. They worked on SARS-CoV-2 spike protein and its receptor binding domain as the vaccine target. So from my earlier slide and this little bit of research work I shared, you can understand that it is important to identify which part we are going to target. And in SARS-CoV-2, mostly it is the spike glycoprotein, its receptor binding domain, and the viral mRNA. Because you understand the receptor binding, if we can target the receptor binding domain, then we can disallow the virus to bind with the human cell receptor. So that will be a good way to protect, to get ourselves protected from the virus and also the mRNA. So the next slide. Here it's a graphical representation. Again, I have collected it from a research. This actually shows the interaction between the viral protein SARS-CoV and SARS-CoV-2 viral spike protein, and also the AC2. This is human receptor protein. So this human receptor, cell membrane receptor binding domain, and the spike protein interaction is actually explained here. And it has been found in this research, they have written in the paper, it has been found that this interaction is quite effective, is effective interaction both for SARS-CoV and SARS-CoV-2. And SARS-CoV-2, for all of us know that receptor recognition is very important for viral infection. And SARS-CoV-2, this interaction with the receptor, the human cell receptor, is very efficient. And scientists are now saying that might be a major reason for the such first spread of the virus, and also maybe the severity. This can be one reason for severity. So the second part of this diagram is showing that if you are immune, if you have the immunity, if you are vaccinated, then these antibodies, this colored, you can see these are the antibodies. They will disallow the SARS-CoV-2 to enter through the receptor domain. So it will disallow the receptor binding, the spike protein and the human AC2 receptor binding, it will disallow. That's the sort of no entry into the cell. So that is how, if we are targeting the spike protein, and that is how it will help in developing immunity and in fighting further infection. Now coming to the trial process. Trial process is, again, all of us know that it is very important for the vaccine development, because by this time, by today's 26th June, we know that according to the New York Times vaccine tracker update, which I followed, 140 vaccines have been developed against this SARS-CoV-2 virus. But amongst these 140 vaccines, we are not very sure how many are going to give the positive results and how many are actually sort of universal vaccine, because this disease is across the universe, so it's across the globe. So we need a universal vaccine, isn't it? That will be applicable for all the countries. It's not Europe or America, it's India also. We will also be, you know, be saved from the viral attack. So this, for this, it is very important, this trial process. Now, actually, speaking technically, the trial process should start with the cell line, then animal model testing, then human trial. Human trial has got 3 phases, but we are in hurry. We don't have that much of time because we need the vaccine very first. So in certain cases, as the, you know, reports say, I have read in the different reports that in certain cases, the trial, I mean, the after, immediately after cell line, they have jumped into the human trial, but not in every cases. Anyways, so this human trial is primarily to dose, defining the dose, which dose will be the right dose, whether there is any, you know, side effects, anything is happening, and the number of human volunteers in phase 1, if it is 100, phase 2, 500, phase 3,000. Likewise, there is a absolutely system. They have to just follow that system, but at every phase, there has to be positive, good result. Otherwise, you cannot proceed to the next. So after 3 phases, you will get approval from the approval authority, depending on whichever country you are. And after that, you know, it will come into the market. So most of these academic institutes, they are collaborating with the pharmaceutical companies for vaccine development, because these pharmaceutical companies will take their research and will develop that and will market the vaccine. So here also I'll share 2-3 instances. As you can see, Moderna, it's a UK-based lab. Moderna vaccine, it's, they work primarily on mRNA. So they have worked on viral mRNA. Viral mRNA protein. And it has crossed phase 1 trial, hope to get the vaccine by early 2021. There is another BioNTech, they have collaborated with Pfizer USA to develop vaccine. Trial process is going on. Researcher at Imperial College London, they have developed mRNA vaccine. Vaccine development by, this is the most discussed one, is the research by Oxford University. They have collaborated with AstraZeneca, and this vaccine trial process has started because I have someone acquainted who is working in this team. So she said that the trial process has started. It is under phase 2 or phase 3, somewhere around phase 2, phase 3. And the trial is going on in England and Brazil. And, you know, it's huge number of people they are testing. And till now, they have got positive result. But one thing in this Oxford University vaccine, when they have done the animal model trial, they have found that 2 shots are required for the right immunity development. So it is again another important point, that the dose, as I was saying, the dose, whether 2 shots are required, because you need to have the right immune response so that you are safe from the next infection. So the next slide, here I am raising this question. See, Professor S.S. Bassan and his team from CSIRO, Commonwealth Scientific Research Organization, they have identified 115 genomic sequences of COVID-19, which means it's not a single strain. Many strains are there of COVID-19, right? So when many strains are there, means various prototypes, that is the question I want to raise. It's not, might be, it's not a major concern, but maybe it will be a concern that whether the immunogenic responses will be same against all the prototypes. You know, I will also give you some idea about the kind of mutation taking place. This is again collected one. I have collected from Microbiology Society. So if you see this one on the right side, you can see, and it is written also, this graph represents the different mutation. The graph on the right is basically map. Here you can see the mutations. It's the China one, original one. When it is coming to European countries, you see the color is changing, which means the strain is different. So Chinese strain and European strain different. And within the Europe also, there are many more strains. And when it is coming from Europe to America, US, the red one is US. See? So it's a matter of few months. If we start from China to, you know, US, it's a matter of few months. By this time, so much of mutation has taken place. On your left, maybe you can see the phylogenetic tree. It's December 19 to February 20, this span of time. So if this is the one, it's the Chinese one, this purple one, and you can see this green-yellow one, the red one. So it has so many branches clustering. If you follow, there are so many branches, which means so much of branches means there is difference. Some difference is there, maybe major, maybe minor differences, but there are differences. The next slide. If you see here, this is mostly in Indian context. Taking 215 viral genomes, this is also again a bioinformatic study. They have prepared this phylogenetic tree having six clusters and so many subdivisions of the clusters you can see here, right? So if we see these, starting this is May 2020, right? 16th May 2020. If this one, the B clade you see here, this is the sample collected from China. So this one, January 19, sorry, 2020, January 15th. Sorry. And the A3 clade you see here, this one, this node, this is sample collected from Ladakh. It has got two mutations. This one, this is sample collected from East Asian country. So this B clade is sample outside India, and A clades are all Indian samples. Among Indian samples, you see A1 clade and A2 clade. A1 and A2 clade, if you see, A1 is two samples collected from Delhi having two mutations. Here, the samples A2 clade, if you see, the samples collected from different states of India, from Karnataka, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, West Bengal, Punjab, UP, Telangana. So this states, this color code actually is state wise. The moral of this whole image is that there are variations in amongst the strains because the mutation is occurring. Now again, there are a lot of scientific work is going on and scientific reports are there on this mutation. I mean, whether these mutations will have, what will be the functional consequence of the mutation basically? Whether these mutations will have some negative effect or whether these mutations will interfere with the efficacy of the vaccine. So research is going on and there are different interpretations also. I just wanted to raise this point because we all are targeting for vaccine. But one thing I want to mention again here, that mutation is a very common phenomenon. It occurs naturally, mutation. And for this particular organism, it's the RNA genome. So RNA genome, when it's getting replicated, it's error-prone replication, right? It's reverse transcription. So it's error-prone. So mutation occurs. Mutation is quite common. Now, no one can actually say, like, what will be the actual functional consequence, because it takes time to understand. That is also very true. University College of London research team has characterized a pattern of variation in SARS-CoV-2 and identified 198 mutations. So different parts of the globe, different research groups are working. They are finding mutations. They are further working on that to understand what will be the functional implication. And in India also, 82 positive cases, 50% are found to have new mutations. But one thing is major concern here, that is the mutation in the spike protein. These 16-14G mutation they have identified in the spike protein of the virus might be helpful for the virus to become a good pathogen. Now, this is one report. Scientists have said that this spike protein mutation, it's a dominant mutation, might be this is helpful for the virus. And it is primarily, it has been found in European Europe and US. It's a dominant mutation they are found, and so the scientists are very much worried because the spike protein receptor binding domain is a major vaccine target. So if it is getting mutated, you can understand when you are getting vaccinated, you are developing antibody, right? So your antibody is against specific epitope, right? if the strain is getting mutated, so there is a chance that the protein will be different, structure of the protein will be different. If the protein structure is different, then the epitope will be different. Then the paratope will not be able to recognize the epitope. So there is a possibility that there won't be the right kind of interaction as we expect from vaccine. Generally speaking, we see that for other flu shots, also people who take flu shots here in India even, every year they take, like for influenza, if we take vaccine for influenza, we have to take every year because the strain is changing. Again, even after taking, you know, this flu shot, person might get infected. I know very recently, I know a case, even after taking the flu shot, the person got infected. The reason is the viral strain is changing. And in case of RNA virus, this is again a major one. But still, I must say, we should be hopeful. Nobody has cleared, and it is not possible. It is difficult to clarify whether or how much will be the, you know, interference of these mutations. But definitely, scientists are worried about, little bit of worried about this mutation of the viral strain. So it's not only vaccine, we also have to have antiviral drugs. Lot of research is going on, all of you know. I have just mentioned two here. Very recently, I came across these two. One is researchers at IIC Bangalore. They have identified as many as 29 drugs. Basically, they have repurposed. This kind of repurposing of the existing drugs is going on. This kind of research is going on all in different places of our country. ICL labs are also doing this kind of research of repurposing drugs. Glenmark Pharmaceutical, they have said that the Fabiflu, very recently it came, it will work on the mild to moderate infected COVID-19 patient. And they have said that they will work with government of West Bengal, you know, in helping them in providing, in treating the COVID patients. And last but not the least, I must say, we should be very positive. And the most important, I personally believe, is that protection. We have to stay protected, and whatever measures government has said. And you know, if we are people from biological science, we need to understand about viral infection, because we can't see this. By this time, we have understood a little bit about this pathogen, about the enemy, but we can't see the enemy. That is the major problem. So basically, stay protected and stay safe. So that is what all I wanted to share. Let me stop sharing, and thank you so much. Let me stop sharing, Dr. Rehan.
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation. Sonali, ma'am.
Hi, thank you. There are some questions, madam. Hello, madam.
Yes, yes.
Dr. Mukherjee, yes, there are some questions. Why scientists not being able to discover vaccine against COVID-19?
Oh, no, it's not that at all. It's not that at all. Scientists are working. As I have said, scientists are working. It is not that at all. It needs time. Vaccine development doesn't happen just like that. It needs time. So it is taking time.
Madam, there is another question. Which types of MHC molecules are present in COVID-19 virus?
It is very difficult to say because it is not yet. Because these kind of work are, it's a protein. It's definitely a protein. But which protein, it is difficult to say. Because these works are very confidential. In fact, this Oxford University team, research team, I had a person who is known to me in this team, but still she has not said anything. I just wanted to ask her, what is your vaccine target? These are very confidential thing, they do not share. And the thing is, it's a protein, but which protein, that is difficult.
Okay, madam, and there another very common question, and this is the last one. When we apply soap in hands, what happens that the virus get destroyed?
When we use soap, you have to remember that we have to use very hard soap. It's not just face wash kind of. Because these, as you have seen, this spike protein, this spike proteins gives it positive adaptation, right? So if you want to remove the virus from your skin, you have to use, you know, soap with higher alkali percentage, actually. Hard soap. And you have to wash it for some time, like people are saying for 20 seconds. you have to move it, you have to, so just to ensure that you are getting rid of virus. And it is better if you can use hot water. Like when I'm returning from college, some days in a week I'm going to college, and when I'm returning, I'm putting, dumping everything into extremely hot water. It's not mild water.
So we cannot use the body soap. We cannot use the body soap.
No, because it's milder version.
Okay.
We have to soap which is having good amount of alkaline.
Okay, thank you, madam. Dr. Rehan?
Yes,
ma'am. Dr. Rehan, please.
Before Rehan, I would like to say a few words.
Yeah.
I again repeatedly requesting the participants, I can name anybody like Tapan Roy, Gorima, or Falguni Bhattacharya, please off your cameras. Please off your cameras. It actually distracts the speaker. And to the participant, please use the chat box for queries only. Please, Rehan, do continue.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Well, our next speaker is Dr. Abul Kalam. He is an individual with terrific scientific temperament. As far as educational qualification is concerned, Dr. Abul Kalam, sir, has done his post-graduation with botany as major subject, along with microbiology as a special paper in the year 1989 from University of Burdwan. After completion of his post-graduation, he had cleared the GATE examination with 87.5 percentile. He completed his doctoral degree from the University of Burdwan in the year 1977. Soon after completion of his doctoral degree, he started his postdoctoral research work on PD fellowship by CSIR, and he took 5 years to complete his postdoctoral research work. In context of research works, we can conclude his core area of research are pesticides biodegradation, fungal biodiversity of East Kolkata, vermicomposting, and food microbiology. He has completed many projects, among them 2 minor projects and 2 major projects sponsored by state and national scientific sponsoring agencies. He has published more than 25 publications in national and international journals of repute. He is a member of many journals as an editorial board as well as reviewer. Now, in a 22 years of academic service, apart from guiding many PG students for dissertation work, he has guided many researchers, and Dr. S. Rehan Ahmed is one of them. So thank you very much, Dr. Abul Kalam sir, for guiding me and as well as many other researchers. Now I would like to request you, please start your session. Sir, Dr. Abul Kalam sir is there. Kalam sir is there. Kalam sir is there.
Am I audible?
Yeah. Yeah, sir. Please carry on, sir.
Okay, thank you. Is my slide showing?
It is about to, sir. You have to start your presentation.
Is my slide visible?
No, sir. You have to minimize, sir. This,
Are you visible?
Now it's visible, sir. Please click on first slide.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Carry on, please.
Well, good morning, everybody. This is my opportunity. I am glad to thank the organizer to give me an opportunity to present my lecture. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please carry on, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
My basic topic is the role of enhanced immunity and immuno booster natural products to fight against COVID-19. I have divided my lecture into two parts. First is the problem of development of vaccine. That is the major problem. That is the treatment of viral infection is two ways. First line of treatment is vaccination, and next any phase is the trial of antiviral drugs or to boost our immunity. Okay. Hello. 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 Am I speaking?
Yeah. Click on the slide, sir. Click on the slide and
okay. Okay.
Yeah, it's fine, sir. Please carry on.
Okay. Thank you. So it is clear that antiviral medicine and vaccines remain the first choice of the treatment in the event of the viral infection. However, with rapid evolution of the viruses and infections that arise due to the continuous mutation with the strain, developing efficacious vaccines and medicines has become an ongoing challenge. As earlier speaker says that the vaccine is a major problem. Preparation of vaccine is not so easy. Vaccines are simple in principle but complex in practice. The ideal vaccine protects against infection, prevents its spread, and does safely, but none of this is easily achieved, as vaccines timelines show. More than 30 years after scientists isolated HIV, the virus that causes AIDS, we have no vaccine. The dengue fever virus was identified in 1943. But the first vaccine was approved only last year. So, production of vaccine and its application is very, very difficult. The fastest vaccine ever developed was for mumps. It took 4 years. The genetic stability of the virus matters too. Some viruses, such as influenza, mutate so rapidly that vaccine developers have to release new formulation each year. The rapid evolution of the HIV is a major reason we have to no vaccine for the disease. The rate of mutation, as we know, in microorganisms is very fast, and in virus it is more than bacteria. So it is very difficult to create a vaccine for the time long. Vaccine development is generally take a long time, and in some cases, many years, the shortest time frame that most experts is about 1 year. But we think 1 year is not possible to create a vaccine or discover a vaccine. As earlier speaker said that the problem of vaccine preparation. That's because the vaccine would have to go through 6 stages, including a 3-phase clinical development stage, according to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC. That is why we need to work together. No single institution has the capacity or facilities to develop a vaccine by itself. There are also more stages to process than many people appreciate. In vaccine, in laboratory, we are identifying the core sector area, but for the commercial product, it needs to collaborate with pharmaceutical company. They produce and commercialize the vaccine. So it is not a single process. First, we have must understand the virus character and behavior in the host human. To do this, we must first develop an animal model. Next, we must demonstrate that potential vaccine are safe and can trigger the right part of the body's immunity without causing damage. Then we can begin preclinical animal testing or potential vaccine using the animal model. Vaccines that successfully pass preclinical testing can then be used by other institutions with the capacity to run human. Where there is will be conducted and by whom has yet to be decided. Generally, it is ideal to test such vaccine in the setting of the current outbreak. Finally, if a vaccine is found to be safe and effective, it will need to pass the necessary regulatory approvals, and the cost-effective way of making the vaccine will also need to be the case before the final vaccine is ready for delivery. One most important thing is the cost effectiveness. If vaccine is highly costing, then not be used by the so many peoples like India. So we must, and the pharmaceutical company also confirmed that the cost effective must be important. So far, coronavirus seems fairly stable, but it acquiring mutation, as all the viruses do. As earlier madam said that it has so many strains so far discovered of the coronavirus. So it is not possible to produce a single vaccine to control all the mutants. Some genetic changes have been spotted in the virus's protein spikes, which are the basis of the most vaccine. If the spike protein mutate too much, the antibodies produced by the vaccine will effectively be out of the date and might not bind the virus effectively enough to prevent the infection. That is the most important point. So we must be careful about the vaccine, and it is a long process. If a COVID vaccine does emerge, one big question is how long immunity might last. It is a big question. If you get the once your immunity is lifelong, then the world, that would be a great training scenario for the world, says O'Donnell of the Pain Preserve Medical Center. However, immunity of cold causing coronavirus typically lasts only a year or two, which suggests that people would need seasonal shot or any other COVID vaccine. In the rush to develop a vaccine, safety must remain a priority. Unlike experimental drug for the severely ill, the vaccine will be given to potentially billions of generally healthy people. So, sometimes during vaccination production, some company or some lab trying to skip the human trials or one phase, two phase trial, but it is not good. That means scientists will have to check experiment carefully for sign or dangerous side effects during the search for a vaccine. Vaccines that contain weakened strain of virus
Sorry for technical error. Shortly, he will resume. Please be with us. Sorry for inconvenience.
Rehan, may I request you to just make a phone call to Professor Abul Kalam? I think he is having a network problem, so please
he is having a network problem. I just speak to him. Shortly he will be available.
I would request the participant to please bear with us. Professor Abul Kalam is facing a major network problem. He will be joining us soon. Within this time period, break time, may I request Professor Mukherjee to address the audience, the questions they have raised. Sonalidhi, can you request Professor Mukherjee to address the audience regarding their questions?
Pradipta, I have already asked Dr. Mukherjee the questions. There are no more questions, I think. Actually, I had also nine network problems, so previous questions are valid.
Okay.
Well, it's okay. We have some announcement for tomorrow. Can I do a
Yeah,
time?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yes, that would be better.
Tomorrow we have an abstract a paper presentation session, right? Well, so I request all the participants who are going to present their abstract or paper must remember, one, be punctual, because I have shared the time schedule. Those who are going to present their paper, they have only 5 + 1 minute. Means they have to present their papers in a stipulated time, which is a 5 minute. And 1 minute we have, you know, keep for interaction session. Suppose after presentation of your paper, if anyone have an inquiry, they can ask within 1 minute. So must remember, you have only 6 minutes overall, 5 minutes for presentation of paper, 1 minute for interacting session. Second is that must remember your chronicle order, who will present the first and the second and third and so on. So these all schedules are already given earlier. Once again, I will share the today's evening. So please maintain the timetable as well as the schedule. That because you know it's difficult to be present the paper by 15 you know participant without any time management. So that I request everyone for tomorrow presentation session must remember their number in chronicle order. They have a time only 5 plus 1 minute, and rest part you will get it in your mail or the common platform which we have created in a WhatsApp. So thank you till now for till now the announcement of we have that much announcement. Yes, ma'am.
There is a question for Dr.
Hello.
Rehan, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Mukherjee is with us. There is a question for Dr. Mukherjee.
Shashmita, ma'am is here.
Yes, I'm here.
There is a question. Is there any difference between COVID-1 and COVID-2?
Actually, it cannot be said that way. What is the difference between COVID-1 and COVID-2? There are a lot of sequence similarity, that much I can say. There are a lot of sequence similarity between COVID-1 and COVID-2. Both are symptom-wise same. Both are having pulmonary, both the virus affect the lung and pulmonary system. But the difference, major difference, I think, in the process of infection. Because of this COVID, the major difference is in the spike protein. That much I can say. The major difference is in the spike protein. Because of this spike protein, this virus has got a good positive adaptability. That way I can say.
India will be. Hello, madam. Hello.
Hello. Are you? Madam. Are you?
I can hear you, but doctor. Yeah. There is a question I was asking Dr. Mukherjee.
Oh.
Okay.
But I think she can't hear me.
Yes, I can hear you, madam.
Achha, have you heard the question? No, I repeat again.
Yes, please.
Achha, will there be different vaccine for different strains of COVID? It means vaccine to combat COVID in India will be different, yes, from US?
It is again difficult to answer, madam. Because, you know, as I said, everybody, all of us are looking for universal vaccine. It is actually difficult to say whether the vaccine research is going on and the vaccine which are developed. The trial is going on across the world. But, you know, this process is so confidential. I cannot say whether people from India has taken for trial. This is one. Secondly, mutations are occurring. There is definitely a concern that the vaccine developed in from the strains collected from UK or US, whether this will be equally applicable in India. But again, research is saying that we can hope, because still we do not know the mutation of the strains, which has taken place, how much the difference is. So that is again not very clear. So only vaccine testing can give the answer to this question.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
Dr. Rehan? Hello, Dr. Rehan? Hello?
I think Rehan is contacting our honorable speaker. In between this, may I request our honorable principal to say a few words about her thought? Our honorable principal, Dr. Shoma Ghosh. May I request Dr. Shoma Ghosh? Madam Shoma Ghosh, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, our honorable principal, madam. She is in college actually. So she is with us. May I request Dr. Shoma Ghosh to give her deliberation? Madam, please unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yes, yes. Rehan,
am I audible?
Yes, yes, madam. You're audible.
So we had wonderful presentations. Perhaps due to certain internet problem, connectivity has been lost. In respect to, I'm telling it in respect to Dr. Kalam. Anyway, we have wonderful presentations, wonderful deliberations. We could have enriched ourselves, I think. And one thing I like to remind all the esteemed participants, certificates are necessary for my younger junior colleagues and friends. But at the same time, we need to enrich ourselves at best as can be possible. Take for example, I'm neither from zoology, neither from any science stream. I'm absolutely from a social science area. My mother discipline is political science. But I loved listening to all the speakers from yesterday. And yesterday, the person who initiated the program, Dr. Pritha Kundu, she is from the Department of English. Today, who has initiated? Sri Pradipta Mukherjee, his mother discipline is political science. But I think that all of us could enrich ourselves by listening to these esteemed speakers. We could have knowledge regarding several aspects, different aspects regarding COVID-19. We know that we have nothing to do. We have to wait for the situation. We have to keep our patience to combat COVID-19. Still, at the same time, being from the academic platform, we need to enlighten ourselves because it is our responsibility, it is our social responsibility to make other people aware as far as practicable. Certificates will be generated in due course. It's my humble request to all the participants, please stay with us. It is being very difficult for our colleagues also, our college members also, to arrange for online webinars. It is not as easy as physical seminars. So please stay with us. Please cooperate with us. And this is my honest request to all the teachers, all the students who are here, that you are our source of inspiration. And this inspiration must go on as we got it in the previous webinars also. Anyway, one of my senior colleague, he will deliver formal vote of thanks. But as a principal of the college, on behalf of all the students, all the non-teaching staff, all the teaching staff, faculty, the teachers who have always provided technical assistance, I convey my thanks and enormous gratitude to our esteemed speakers who spared some of their valuable times for us to enlighten us, as well as to the participants who are still here to listen to us, to encourage us in organizing such webinars. I'd like to request Pradipta Mukherjee to go for next part of the proceedings.
Yeah, in between these, Dr. Kalam has joined us again. So may I request Dr. Kalam to continue, please?
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Dr. Kalam, please continue.
Kalam sir, may I audible you? Dr. Kalam sir is there. Actually, he has having a severe internet problem.
So I would Rehan, please, yes, ask sir. Him. Please ask him to send you the PPT so that you can post it to the group and. Yeah. Tomorrow, if we have time, then we could give him more time to deliver his lecture. And if you could, since I am not being able to hear from him, Abul Kalam sir.
Exactly.
So could you do that?
Yeah. I will request him to. Yeah, hope he is presenting start.
He started his presenting, but he need to unmute himself.
Actually, that is why he is unable.
Kalam sir, please unmute yourself. Kalam sir, please unmute yourself.
He is not listening up. So how he will do?
I think Kalam sir has muted his speaker also. Can anyone contact him?
Yes, ma'am. I'll call him. Yes, I'll call him.
He has muted his speaker.
आप सुनाई दे रहा है ना?
Yes sir, you are audible sir. Please continue. Dr. Kalam, please continue.
Do you sing? Hello.
please minimize the screen. Yes, please carry on.
Yeah.
Yes, open your slide. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, please. Please carry on from there. You stop. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Please.
Thank
you. Yeah, yeah, please carry on, sir.
For inter for patient rooms. So the foods, including mushrooms. Mushroom as a vitamin D source, find that sunshine vitamin can help enhance the absorption of calcium, which is good for bone health and also protect against excess of restricted. Is the rich vitamin full of antioxidants and helping our immune cells from environment. As it has beta carotene, which is the main dietary source of vitamin A, as essential components. Or slightly cooked. Next, sunflower seeds are high vitamin E, which works as tomato oil, ginger oil, in improving. For a
Clansar, am I audible you? Sorry for interruption, may I audible you? Sir, we are unable to hear you properly. So I request you, sir, please either conclude it or it's a better if we will do same tomorrow. Am I audible you, sir? Sir, we are unable to hear you. So I request you, sir, please conclude the session. Or it's better you, we will
hello,
do
hello.
Same. Sir, we are unable to hear you properly due to extreme poor network. So I request you, sir, please conclude the session.
May I request Dr. Kalam to for one privilege? That is, there seems to be a very serious internet connectivity problem from Dr. Kalam's end. So, can we have him tomorrow?
because he is trying ruthlessly, but we can't hear him. So may I request Dr. Kalam to continue his session tomorrow? Professor, I'd like to request Professor Dibakanto Jha to have some suggestion in this regard, because he is the senior most colleague of in our college. And there is also Dr. Sonali Mukherjee. May we request Dr. Kalam to continue his session tomorrow? So,
yes, madam, please request him. Please request him.
Dibakanto Da, am I audible? So, Pradipto? Hello? Pradipto, let's end the session for today. And yes. I'd request Rehan, Dr. Rehan, to talk to Dr. Kalam again. If he can have some time for us tomorrow.
Okay, ma'am.
So, Rehan, we are proceeding to our Honorable Professor Dibakanto Jha for the vote of thanks. Professor Jha.
Yes. Please, Dibakanto Jha is there.
Sir, please unmute yourself. Professor Jha, please unmute yourself.
Please, sir, conclude the session by giving vote of thanks to speakers and others.
Dibakanto, sir, please unmute yourself. Tap on the screen and then there will be a microphone icon. Then please talk to Professor Kalam.
Yeah.
Vibhakanto sir, unmute yourself please. Tap to screen, then there will be a microphone sign icon. You need to click it. It will be red right now.